So, I don't think it would be a huge surprise to anyone who's followed me for a while now when I say that I'm a longtime fan and still somewhat active player of Team Fortress 2. Valve may no longer care about TF2 and in general not really caring about game development in particular, but I still very much do. And yes, I'm aware Valve did release Half-Life Alyx last year, and forgive me if I don't feel like sucking them off because they made literally one single VR game while spending the last decade canceling over a dozen others, including recently buying out an indie studio with the explicit result of permanently shelving their nearly completed game. But as usual, while Valve continues to not give a damn about anything outside of the Steam storefront, the TF2 community has decided to completely shut Valve out of the equation, instead creating an entirely community-operated major update by the name of Operation Digital Directive. Digital Directive is an enormous update centered exclusively around providing a whole host of all-new maps, weapon skins, and other content for the long-standing official co-op horde mode Man vs. Machine. Man vs. Machine has found itself in a kind of an odd spot for the past 7 or 8 years. While Valve has continued to add more and more community maps into the official game for many other official game modes like Capture the Flag, Control Point, King of the Hill, Payload, etc., they seem oddly hesitant to do the same for Man vs. Machine, which is especially odd as Man vs. Machine has remained one of the most popular game modes in the game since its creation, if official matchmaking queue times and the number of active community-run MVM servers are anything to go by. But that's the direction Valve has decided to go in, and the community has taken the correspondingly opposite path, which I'm more than happy with. Operation Digital Directive was the result of a collaboration between two of the largest surviving TF2 custom server communities, Creators.TF and Potato MVM. Potato MVM was responsible for developing the actual MVM maps and missions in this update, and Creators.TF focused more on developing the unofficial third-party achievement system and cosmetics that players could unlock through extensive play and use on those servers. Also, Creators.TF prominently took charge of the organizational planning as well as the marketing and PR work needed to successfully pull players in. So, for the sake of argument, while both teams had development-related tasks, you could argue that the Potato MVM community acted as the primary developer for this update, whereas Creators.TF fulfilled the role of a publisher. Operation Digital Directive brings with it 22 new maps, or rather, roughly 20 new maps. At least two of the maps featured in this community event I'm pretty sure are just reskins of existing TF2 maps that have been converted to support Man vs. Machine. Suffice it to say, this community endeavor has been off to a fantastic start. Almost 40 community servers spinning across the US, Australia, Europe, and Brazil, and almost all of them have been constantly maxed out in regards to player count. I've had to wait anywhere from 10 minutes to almost an hour to get into a match, and as I've wanted to test out as many of the newly added maps as possible, it's taken me several days to get all the necessary footage. While I don't think I've been on all 22 maps, I played on probably at least 17 or 18 of them so far. I may not be a completionist, but I did feel it was important to get a general idea of what I'm critiquing. I had a decent bit of fun on most of the maps, though I did notice the quality did greatly vary from map to map. There were lots of slight balance-related issues. For one, some of the campaigns marked as advanced, a difficulty at which I generally find to my liking, actually seemed one difficulty higher than they were marked as. When playing an advanced difficulty MVM map, you don't expect it to be roughly on par with the infamous Wave 666 on the Ghost Town map. I had a group of 7 or 8 players, and I think we were on one of those servers that raises the normal MVM player count cap from 6 to 8, and we still found ourselves completely unable to survive more than 2 rounds of that map. And from what I saw of those players' performance as their respective characters, everyone had decent positioning, fairly good mechanical skill, and at least adequate map knowledge and awareness given that most of us were playing the map for the first time. We had spent the first 5 minutes or so just walking around and familiarizing ourselves with the robot's route to the final point, where the health and ammo packs were, alternate flanking routes, and other useful information. But you can do everything mostly right and still lose in some of these maps because there's an over-reliance on giant robots pocketed by multiple Uber medics and an assortment of tanks at any given time. The logic of some of these highlighted community mapmakers seems to be more is better, when this isn't at all correct. More isn't better, more isn't worse, more is just, well, more. The visual quality of the maps was likewise hit or miss. Some, especially those that mainly relied on pre-existing TF2 assets, looked either great or at the very least fine, but some of the more original maps, like the underwater one I played a few days ago, looked like a rushed, unfinished Unity engine prototype level. I wonder if, in their rush to clump together as many maps into one single bundled community event, if a certain degree of polish was overlooked. Without knowing the development history of the aforementioned maps, it's impossible to say, but again, having more for the mere sake of having more is relatively meaningless if you have to sacrifice time and/or resources for the sake of expedited progress. There's been a few changes to some of the core MVM mechanics, such as the cost of certain character upgrades being dramatically increased, certain additional follow-up levels of upgrades being disabled entirely, which I'm not a big fan of, etc. I think one of the reasons Man vs. Machine works and continues to maintain a fairly high number of average concurrent players is because it, within the official supported capacity, is a fairly balanced and, more importantly, very entertaining game mode. While you can always try to make something more balanced, it's not as important when the mode in question is inherently a cooperative player versus environment type mode, because simply put, the robots aren't going to complain if a certain weapon is slightly overpowered once you maximize the available upgrades. No one plays games like TF2 because they want a perfectly balanced game that appeals primarily or exclusively to high-skill competitive players. There are plenty of games that do appeal to those markets, and many others that try to strike a balance between listening to the average player and the top-tier professional ones. So while I admire this community's attempt at creating their own semblance of balance, I think they're tragically misapplying the concept to a specific mechanic in a specific mode where, for the most part, it couldn't matter less. The Digital Directive update, in short, is a solid but largely unremarkable update that attempts to introduce a few interesting bells and whistles that would have been better served focusing less on experimentation and more on quality control and providing a few additional servers to accommodate the demand they knew was likely going to be present with the arrival of such an event. That said, I do appreciate the effort and enthusiasm that went into the production of this content, and I hope Valve at least partially relents and adds at least some of this content officially into the core game. On that note, that's where I think I'm going to wrap it up for today. Let me know what you think of this newest TF2 community update in the comments down below. I know a fair amount of you either actively still play TF2 or at least have done so at some point in the past. Even if you've never tried TF2 before, I'll be curious to hear your opinions and debate it with you in the comments section down below. If you want to support the work I do in this channel, do consider subscribing and clicking the bell to opt into getting notifications whenever a new video goes live. I record new game reviews, first impressions, and other game and critique related content every week. As we're just barely into the second quarter of 2021, there hasn't been an enormous number of interesting games to review. Also, I'm currently a full-time student and part-time retail worker, so there's that too. But as we get further into the year, I expect the game release calendar will start to ramp up once again. As most of you who've been watching this channel for a while now will know, I'm currently aiming to cross over 2,000 subscribers by the end of the year. If I do so, I plan to give $100 to Team Trees, a nonprofit initiative aimed at combating climate change by planting millions of trees every year. Since its founding in October 2019, the group has planted over 22 million trees. I'm a big believer in giving back. Last year, I promised I would give $50 if my channel hit 1,000 subscribers. Well, I'm doubling down this year, so if you're looking for a secondary incentive to subscribe to me, aside from wanting to stay up to date with my reasonably decent content, there you go. That said, this is Warrior Dan signing out. Stay awesome, everybody. Stay safe and peace out.